Hi there! Mike MacArthur from the Oshkosh Public Library here to thrill you with some more Librarian Learns. This is the series where I take a look at some bits of Oshkosh history that I've been asked about while at the library or that I have wondered about myself as I've been living here. So today we're going to take a look at the Athern Hotel. And I will say that no other building in Oshkosh casts as big a shadow as the Athern, which is impressive in that it hasn't been here for nearly half a century. And people are still ticked off about its demolition back in 1965. The Athern was built in the late 1880s, which were truly boom years for Oshkosh. Industry was booming. This was truly the high point for the Sawdust City, and it was the second biggest city in the state, next to Milwaukee. But Oshkosh lacked that premier hotel worthy of its size and newfound stature. After some embarrassing news stories about travelers unable to find quality lodgings in the city, the idea of creating a first-class hotel in the city really started to materialize. The project was led by local hotelier George W. Athern. It was designed by local architect William Waters and was built by local contractor C.W. Myers, which had only been in business for 3 years when they got the Athern job. The people of Oshkosh actually got to vote on the name of their new Grand Hotel. Of course, George Athern made no promises that he would abide by their selection, but would use it as, quote, a valuable guide. Well, lucky for everyone, they selected the Athern as the name of the new hotel, though the Arion came in a close second, named for the local musical band. The Athern opened in May of 1891. The Athern was a massive structure that was a dominant architectural presence downtown. Article from the Weekly Times in 1889 described it as thus: "The style of architecture is Romanesque. The material used will be red pressed brick with cut stone trimmings from local quarries. The building will measure 80 feet on High Street, 150 on Division, 120 on Market, and 160 on the rear alley. It will have 4 stories and a basement." Again, this was no business hotel designed for traveling salesmen, kind of like the State Hotel or the Revere House. The Athern was designed to impress. It had intricate oak woodwork, lavishly designed dining rooms and parlors, billiard rooms, a bar, and like most hotels of its day, a barber shop. It was truly an establishment to impress the fanciest and most high-end travelers to Oshkosh. Being pretty much the premier hotel north of Milwaukee, it had its fair share of famous guests, including President William Howard Taft, famous lawyer Clarence Darrow, famous actress Maude Adams, the 14th Justice of the Supreme Court, Earl Warren, and famed big band leader Duke Ellington. So the Athern was run by the Athern family until 1954, when Fred Athern, the eldest son of George Athern, decided to retire due to his failing health. The business changed hands several times before January of 1952, where it was leased by the Anderson Hotel Operating Corporation. This corporation was run by the McCaffrey family. The McCaffrey family had been in the hotel business for multiple generations and had really had a high reputation for quality food. Under the McCaffrey sisters' management, the Athern was known for elegance and fine dining experiences. On Saturday night, the main dining room was transformed to fit different themed meals, such as chuck wagon western-themed suppers or plantation nights with a southern theme. So this might kind of seem a little hokey today, or in the case of the plantation nights with its busboys dressed as Confederate soldiers, a little problematic. But at the time, this was really a very unique and novel dining experience, executed with a high level of culinary expertise and formality that really wasn't seen in any other part of the city. Again, this was not your typical Friday night fish fry at the local tavern. This was the fancy place you got dressed up to go to. The Athern also served as a prime meeting spot for conventions, weddings, dances, parties, formals, all throughout the 1950s. It even served as a college dormitory for the late 50s and early 60s, while the UWO campus was expanding. Despite the number of upgrades and improvements the McCaffrey family made to the Athern, it was starting to show its age and becoming increasingly expensive to maintain and keep up to modern-day safety code. In April of 1961, the banks ordered the hotel sold to basically pay for its debts. In August of 1964, it was announced that the Athern had been purchased by the New American Bank and was to be demolished and turned into a parking lot. So in late 1964, the last 48 permanent residents of the Athern were moved out, including Dolly Athern, who was the wife of Fred Athern and had lived and worked in the Athern for most of her life. In came the wrecking ball, and by spring of 1965, all that remained of the Athern was an empty lot. Interesting note, the rubble from the Athern demolition was used to help build the Pioneer Island. So the big question with this is always, could it have been saved? Well, in 1961, 1964, it had a lot going against it. The biggest problem was its original construction. The entire hotel was made out of wood, which in 1890 made total sense. We were the Sawdust City. Of course, you build the thing out of wood. It was plentiful, cheap, and of high quality. But by 1961, it made the building a fire trap. So maybe they could have thrown enough money at it to replace the wood structure with concrete or steel, but that was just not economically feasible in the early 60s. The hotel industry had undergone a massive change. People wanted different amenities in their hotels, like personal bathrooms in the room. They might not actually care that the hotel has a barbershop, but they were definitely looking for ones with pools. Additionally, you know, travelers were now frequently traveling by car, and drivers wanted ample parking, preferably right in front of their hotel room, and they could get this at any number of new motels that had sprung up along Highway 41. And finally, there was the kind of urban renewal mentality of the 1960s. There just wasn't a culture of preservation in the 60s for these types of buildings that there are today. No one was having discussions about how to try to convert the Athern into suitable apartments or things like that. So with all that going against it, it seemed unlikely that the Athern could have even survived. But the Athern left a huge legacy. So here I am in Opera House Square. As you can see right behind me, the Civil War Monument, which used to point directly at the Athern, which is where basically where that BMO Harris Bank parking lot and drive-through is today. Kind of feels like a big hole now, doesn't it, when you know what used to be there. The one big lasting legacy of the Athern, I should say the loss of the Athern, was the Grand right behind me. So I made a video a couple of weeks ago or months ago talking about how the Grand was saved. Really, the push to save the Grand happened as the Athern came down. That same year, 1965, when they lost the Athern, you really started that grassroots community movement to try to save the Grand, because with the Athern gone, the Grand was going to be next. So you might be able to say that the Athern had to fall so that the Grand could rise. So hey, I learned something. Again, like always, if you like these videos, hit like, hit subscribe, share it with your friends. Please share your memories if you remember going to the Athern in the comment section of wherever you're seeing this. And with that, I'll see you later.